I think it's important to point out that Fairphone also has objectives that are not so much within circular economy, I would say. So when you talk about resources, we also very much look at what are the social conditions. You know, those resources are taken from the ground, and that's all our initiatives in mining. We need to think what are the next steps, right? And even though if we could say, okay, tomorrow we have a completely circular model, there would still be mining happening, right? Mm. So we have to kind of level both. What we've done with Fairphone One, for instance, was to make sure if we think of the market as a system and we say, okay, we are going to put in the market so many phones, can we also take out you know, so many phones from the system even before we put them into the market? And that's our project that we've done in Ghana with recovering electronic waste and shipping it back to Belgium to get recycled properly. So that was a little bit with that thinking of, okay, we're putting, you know, thousands of devices in the market. Let's take actually three times the amount of devices we've put in the market we've taken out from Ghana, and we saved them from landfill.
So are there any design principles from Circular that you think you apply in the development of the product?
For us, it's really on longevity to start with. If you look at it, you know, half of the CO2 emissions are done in the manufacturing, in the whole life cycle of a mobile phone, come from manufacturing. So if you can delay that manufacturing again as much as possible, we think that's the right approach for us. At the same time, being a startup, I don't think we do use like very well thought through design methods, I would say. There's a lot of ad hoc, of course, a lot of we also plan and do our strategies. But with that aim of bringing a product that, that can have a long long life, that can be repaired, that, you know, also with the idea of giving that ownership back to consumers, you know, that they are responsible for what they buy and they don't feel like powerless when something breaks. I think that's our line of thought. Yeah.
We also give them. We also give the people we're working with some strange rules on not using some very specific materials, which we know are troublesome in the supply chain at some point, right? So we can give those non-orthodox rules, even though all the other companies are basically used to doing things like that, right? So, for example, we try to avoid using any coatings on the plastics. Because we know, for example, in China, the production is very harmful because they use a lot of volatile organic compounds in the spraying system. Whereas in Europe, it's actually much better because they use waterborne systems. So we try to avoid as much as possible any coatings, any extra secondary operations on the parts we produce. We've seen in the last 2 years since we came into existence, a number of consumers are actually paid up front money for a product that they've never seen from a company that never existed, never did anything similar to that. I mean, it's tremendous. And now that we're basically growing to a certain maturity level where we can actually show that we can bring products to market that can make a difference, hopefully, will surely attract more customers.